God bless you. You may be seated. Let's take our Bibles out. We'll turn to the book of Romans chapter 2. We're continuing our study through the second chapter of the book of Romans. This morning, the title of our message is Crushing the Confidence of Outward Religion. And Paul's been teaching us about the most powerful, most important message, the most needed message that's ever existed on the face of the earth. That is the gospel message. There's no greater, no more important news than any person could ever learn than the fact that God loved us so much that He sent His Son Jesus Christ into this world to die for sinners on the cross, pay the price of our sins. And He was raised up on the third day, victorious over death and sin and hell. He conquered death and sin and hell for us. He offers us, through the power of His resurrection, He offers us eternal life in heaven with Him forever and ever. Amen. That's the best news there is. And all you need to do is just trust Him. Trust what He did for you there at Calvary. That's the message that Paul is trying to make clear to all people. Yet the problem is many people have no idea how important that message is. Many people have no idea how much they need that message. So Paul's been explaining why all people need the gospel so desperately. And that is because we're all guilty of sin. Back in Romans chapter 1, Paul was talking about the really big sinners, the professional sinners, the ones who do the really bad stuff. You know, that's kind of the way we look at it. Everybody knows the stuff they do is wrong. But then we started making our way through Romans chapter 2, and Paul started talking to people who seem outwardly moral and seem outwardly religious. And Paul told them that they're guilty before God too. He said, you do the same things. May not be the exact same sins, but you still sin before God, and you're still guilty. And he said to them that they're not going to escape the judgment of God either. And as we come to Romans chapter 2 this morning, and verse number 17, Paul now turns to the religious Jew. Now, the Jews were probably the most religious people who've ever lived. Nobody had more religion than they did. If any people on earth could make the claim that they knew the law of God more than anybody else, it was the Jewish people, because all the way back to Abraham, God kept His covenant with Israel. God showed His power through Israel. God gave His word through Israel. And all of that gave the people of Israel, the religious Jews, it gave them a lot of confidence. If they were such a special people that God would do such special things through them and use them for such important purposes, then they felt like their relationship with God must be okay. But as we come to Romans chapter 2 and verse 17 this morning, Paul is about to confront the religious Jew, and he's about to make the case that he's a sinner too, just like all the others, and they need the gospel just as much as anybody else in the world. And really what Romans chapter 1 through Romans chapter 3, 1, 2, and 3, what these chapters do for us, they do something that absolutely has to be done for us if we want to be saved. And that is, it humbles our hearts and strips us away from any thoughts of pride that we might have had before. So if you're trying to come to God's presence and you're thinking, God will accept me because I'm a good person, because I do these religious things, then what Paul says in Romans 1 through 3 is going to disappoint you greatly. Because Paul's going to say, no, you're not a good person. You're just as much a sinner as anybody else in the world. And your good works and your religion are not enough to make you right with God. So you need the gospel too. So I want to show you how Paul goes about this. And we're going to see 5 major points this morning. So if you're following along in your outline, you can look to that this morning. Point number 1, Paul talks about their false confidence. Paul's going to talk about 3 things that these religious Jewish people held on to that was their confidence. It had to do with their religion and their heritage. And he talks about how they held on to these things and they trusted in these things. These are the things they were resting on that they felt like made them acceptable in the sight of God. First of all, we're going to see the first false confidence that they had is that they felt like they had a connection. They felt like they had a connection with God. And in verse number 17, first part of the verse, Paul says, indeed, you are called a Jew. All right? We're going to see that in the beginning of the text. Paul's going to say to them, you are called a Jew. We're going to get down to the end of the text, and Paul's going to give them kind of a different definition of what God sees as a Jew, and it's a lot different than what they think. But he says, indeed, you are called a Jew. That's the first thing the religious Jews took great confidence in, that they were the Israelites. They were the descendants of Abraham, through whom God made his covenant all the way back to Genesis chapter 12. And it's a great covenant. The Lord told Abraham, I will make you a great nation. I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. And God dwelt in the midst of the nation of Israel from the time that he led them out of Egypt and destroyed the armies of Egypt. And he dwelt with them during the time that he led them through the wilderness, and he provided for them food to eat and water to drink, everything that they needed, shade over their heads. He provided for them, and he dwelt with them during the time when he led them across the Jordan into Canaan, and he began to defeat their enemies before their eyes and drive them out of the land and give that land and their homes and the wells they didn't dig, the homes they didn't build, into the Israelites' hands. God really blessed them. And the presence of the Lord came down, the Bible tells us, into the midst of that tabernacle, in the midst of the city of Jerusalem, in the thick dark cloud, and it dwelt there in the tabernacle in the midst of the children of Israel. God's presence dwelling among them. And so evident and powerful was the Lord's presence among the children of Israel that all the nations around them would tremble in the presence of Israel, because they knew that Israel's God is the most powerful God, the one true God. And in fact, when Joshua sent a couple of spies into the land of Jericho, remember the story about how Rahab the harlot hid them on her rooftop. And I'm sure that when they came back and told him the whole story, he says, good night, I send you guys into the town and you end up at a prostitute's place. How's that happen? But it's kind of a funny story. And she ended up hiding them and helping them. And she ended up being blessed because she hid them from the people of the city. And the Bible says that she said to them, said, I know that the Lord has given you the land, that the terror of you has fallen on us, and that all the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were on the other side of the Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. And as soon as we heard these things, our hearts melted, neither did there remain any more courage in anyone because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and on the earth beneath. That's what the people and the nations around Israel were saying. And can you imagine being a nation that's blessed in such a way by God's presence that all the nations around you fear because they know your God is the true God of heaven and earth? And what a great blessing that God would use the nation of Israel in such a way to demonstrate his glory and his power to the world. And it's something that the people of Israel should have been very thankful for. But the problem was, instead of being thankful for it like they should have been, they became prideful in it. And instead of glorifying God in this like they should have, they tried to glorify themselves as if they were the greatest people on the face of the earth and every other nation was beneath them. And because God had his hand on Israel in such a special way throughout their history, many of the religious Jews began to feel like they had an inside track with God that made them acceptable in the sight of God just because they were an Israelite. And then there's another thing. Not only did they have a connection with God, Paul talks about the fact that they knew the law. That's the second thing. Verse 17 goes on, it says, and you rest on the law and make your boast in God and know his will and approve the things that are excellent, being instructed out of the law. And look at that. He says, you rest on the law. And remember, the Lord gave his law to the Israelites while they were out there in the wilderness. He gave the Ten Commandments to Moses up there while he was up in the mountain. And he didn't choose to give that law to Egypt when they were the wealthiest and most powerful nation on the earth. He chose to give that law to Israel when they were homeless and wandering around in the desert. He gave them the law. He gave them the standard by which the holiness and perfection of God is demonstrated to the whole world. And because God chose to do such a special thing through Israel, many of the religious Jews came to believe that that made them very unique and very special. And they didn't just receive that law. They studied it and they learned it and they came to know it very well. Every commandment, every verse, every line, every word, every last mark, they memorized it and they knew that law. They felt like that made them acceptable in God's sight too. And that brings us to a third thought, because not only did they receive it and know it, but they taught the law. Do you think the fact that I get up here and teach every week the Bible, that I study and know the Bible, and I get up and teach the Bible every week, do you think that's going to get me into heaven? No, not at all. And that's what they thought. Verse number 19, he said, "You are confident that you yourself are a guide to the blind, a light to those in darkness." Man, everybody else needs my help because I'm so great. "An instructor of the foolish, a teacher of babes, having the form of knowledge and truth in the law." And this is the part they really love. They love being called rabbi. They love being called master. They love being called teacher. And Jesus said, don't be called by those titles. Don't call anyone father. He said, if you're going to be called anything, be called a brother. Because we're brethren. And we have one father. God's our father. But they loved it. They loved those titles and they loved that position because it set them up in a position over other people and it appealed to their pride and it made them feel really good about themselves, like they were more important than anybody else. They had all their religious groups too. They had the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the priests and the scribes, and they had their 70 ruling elders who sat on the Sanhedrin council, and they were always seeking after titles and positions. And they loved to receive honor and attention from men. And somehow they allowed themselves into thinking that God had admired them in the same way that they had deceived men into admiring them. But all that was false confidence. All these things they believed about themselves were false assurance, built on the lie that man can somehow be good enough, be special enough, by their own efforts to please God through religion. And do you know how good you have to be to please God? If you're going to live by the law of God, you know how good you have to be to please God? You have to be absolutely perfect. And there's a lady here right now. She can witness for the prosecution. She will stand up and testify. Well, she went to get chicken, but she's not here right now. But Bridget would tell you, if she was here right now, she would tell you that I am not perfect, right? If I said that right now, she would have said amen. Rachel, am I perfect? No. Am I imperfect? Amen. All right, she says yes. She didn't even hesitate, didn't even bat an eye. None of us are, but if you want to be acceptable according to the law in the eyes of God, you have to be absolutely perfect. And let me tell you something, listen to me, no other man has ever lived like that outside of Jesus Christ himself. He's the only one who ever lived according to the law like that. He's the only one who ever fulfilled the law like that. And so they had a false confidence, and Paul crushes that false confidence. All your connection to God and all your knowing of the law, all of your that you think you have and all that teaching of the law, it doesn't make you right in God's sight. Second point that we come to this morning is their flawed character. That's next in our outline on number two. They had a flawed character. In verse number 21, Paul says to them, "You therefore who teach another, do you teach yourself?" That's an important question. And in that, we begin to see the heart of the problem, that these men who love to call themselves teachers of the law are really having a problem when it comes to actually obeying it. And the question is, if that law is so important for men to live by, then why aren't you living by it yourself? And back in verse 13, Paul already said it doesn't do any good just to hear the law if you're not going to obey it. And here he's telling us not to act like teachers of the law either if we're not actually going to obey it. You can honestly stand up there and warn people about how important God's law is when you don't even care to live under that law yourself. And Paul asks us some questions to get us thinking about that. I mean, I know you teach, you bring a good game when it comes to teaching it, but how does your life match up with that? And here's the first question in verse 21, second part of verse 21. Paul asks, "You who preach that a man should not steal, do you steal?" All right, good question. And our natural inclination is to say, no, I don't steal, I never steal, I'm not a thief. But you need to think carefully before you answer that question. Have you ever stolen time from your employer? Do you ever sit down and rest when you're being paid to be up busy working? Or have you ever called up the boss and told him that you were sick when you really weren't? You were just, you are the boss. You were just wanted to take a day off. And so you came by that benefit dishonestly. Have you ever received a benefit that you weren't qualified for and you know that you got it dishonestly? When you're going through the line at a restaurant or a movie theater, have you ever lied about how old your kids are? You be careful. It was at a Poncho's out in North Richland Hills. I got convicted about that one. Because you can teach your kids how to lie and steal at a very young age. Let me ask you this. How many of you stole your tithes and offerings from the Lord right here this morning? Leviticus 27 says the tithe belongs to the Lord. It's holy to the Lord. Malachi 3 says, will a man rob God? But you have robbed me. You say, well, how have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. And he says, you are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me. That's what God's word says. God says that. If you've withheld from God the tenth part of your income, which belongs to Him, which is holy to Him, and you've kept it for yourself, you have stolen that from God, which belongs to Him. And what do you call a person who steals? That's right. So before you answer that question, say, no, I don't steal. Answer that question honestly with God. And then Paul asks another question, because Paul, God knows what we've done. Then Paul asks another question. He says, you who say do not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? All right, and again, the natural inclination is for us to say, no, I've never cheated on my wife. I absolutely would never think about it. Be careful before you answer that way, because Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 28, that whoever looks on a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If you've ever looked at a woman and thought the wrong kind of thoughts about her, I can remember the preacher standing up at a fellowship meeting one time and saying, you know, I could stand up in a room full of a whole bunch of naked ladies and not think of one bad thought. My dad said, what made you think about a whole bunch of naked ladies? That's a pretty bad thought right there. And these Pharisees, you know, Jesus talked, he confronted the religious Pharisees who were so religious and they knew the law so well. But you know what? They misused God's law. They didn't live by the spirit of God's law. They tried to live by the letter of God's law. And they would use God's law in order to commit adultery. One of the things that they would do, the Bible says if your wife displeases you, you can write her a bill of divorcement. But the thing was that it was if your wife had been unfaithful to you and had committed adultery on you, you could divorce her. It was only in the case of adultery. But these guys would just say, you know, that God has commanded us, if our wife displeases us, to divorce our wives. And they would write their wife a bill of divorcement, and they'd go to another woman, and they'd be married to her. And they said, there's nothing wrong with it. And then they would divorce that wife, and they would marry another one. They were doing it all. They were committing adultery with one woman after another, and they were saying it was okay because they had a piece of paper that said it was okay. And I wrote her out a bill of divorcement, just like the law says. That law was in place to protect people from a cheating, adulterous spouse. It wasn't there so you could go be a person who had every woman that you wanted. And these guys were committing adultery. And Jesus confronted the religious Jews about that, and he said that it is adultery. You're committing adultery all over the place. Verse number 22, second part of verse 22, he asks another question. He says, you who abhor idols, do you rob temples? Now, idols are an evil thing. And the word abhor, it means to hate them. And the second commandment, Exodus chapter 20 and verse number 4, says, you shall not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that's in heaven above, or that's in the earth beneath, or that's in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them, nor worship them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. You're not supposed to worship. You're not supposed to have images that you worship. And the idea is that, you know, I didn't make God. God made me. God is so glorious, I cannot convey him. I cannot make a sculpture of him that would give him enough glory due his name. And God carries me. I can't pick him up and carry him around. And I'm not going to pray to some little trinket. I'm going to pray to him. And it's spiritual pornography to be in love with an idol. But here's the thing. There were these guys who were preaching against idolatry. And Paul asked them the question, do you rob temples? And I want to take you to another verse of Scripture back in the book of Deuteronomy. I can read it to you. Deuteronomy chapter 7 and verse 25. When the Lord was telling the children of Israel about going into Canaan and how they were supposed to conduct themselves when they went in to conquer that land. He said to them in Deuteronomy 7, 25, he said, you shall burn the carved images of their gods with fire. You shall not covet the silver or gold that's on them, nor take it for yourselves, lest you be snared by it, for it's an abomination to the Lord your God, nor shall you bring an abomination into your house, lest you be doomed to destruction by it. You shall utterly detest it and utterly abhor it, for it is an accursed thing. The problem was, as much as these Israelites claimed to hate idols, when they went in to conquer these pagan cities, they would go into the temples and they would steal all the gold and silver idols, and they would take anything else that looked like it had any value so that they could sell it and keep the money. And so the thing that they claimed to hate so much because it was sin against God, they really enjoyed it. They really loved it because they were making money. They were making a profit from it. And the Lord commanded them not to do that. And Paul has laid the charges out here. These religious teachers were not living in obedience to the law that they claimed made them acceptable before God. Said you're not doing it. A third point, because there's a consequence, the fierce consequence. That's our third point. There's a consequence to all this. You stand up and you claim that you are the giver of God's law, and you don't live by it. Paul says there's a consequence for that. Verse 23, he says, you who make your boast in the law, do you dishonor God through breaking the law? Right? You get that, what Paul's saying there? When you as a Christian go out into the world and you commit some kind of sinful act, the world sees that and your actions bring dishonor to God's name. You understand that? See, when I was a kid, I learned how to work on things, and sometimes I would borrow tools from the neighbors. My dad would always tell me, son, you take care. When you borrow something from the neighbor, you take care of it. You don't break it. If you break it, you buy them a new one. You make sure, and you take it back to them clean and in good condition. And what God has given us is His name and His reputation. He has put us on it. And if you're going to go out into the world with God's name, you need to be careful what you do with God's name. And don't bring it back to Him tarnished. Don't bring it back to Him polluted. Don't bring it back to Him with something shameful. And you go out there and you're driving around with your Christian fish and your honk if you love Jesus sticker on your car, and you're wearing your Castleberry Baptist Church t-shirt, and you go out there and you live like a Methodist and you're cussing like a Pentecostal. Be careful what you do. Be careful what you say, where you go, what you get involved in, because you wear the name of Jesus Christ, and you should not do something that would bring shame to His name. Paul goes on to say in verse 24, he said, the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you, as it is written. And when he says as it is written, it says it's a scripture. He's quoting from Isaiah chapter 52. And what he's talking about is when you, as a representative of Jesus Christ, a Christian, you go out into the world wearing Christ's name and you do wicked things, and you're giving them ammunition to say evil things about God. They say, what? Did you see what that person did? He's supposed to be a Christian. If that's what Christianity is about, I don't want anything to do with it. Right? I'm preaching myself this morning. Fourthly, they have their false confidence. All those things they had false confidence in. They have their flawed character. They have the fierce consequence. They're going to bring shame to God's name. Fourthly, we have the futile ceremony. Futile. It's useless. In verse 25, he says, for circumcision is indeed profitable if you keep the law. But if you are a breaker of the law, your circumcision has become uncircumcision. All right. Some of you weren't expecting that word. I saw some of you guys who aren't very mature start to giggle. Okay. Grow up now. Okay. In the spirit, church this morning on the fifth Sunday with all the children in here, we're going to keep this as PG as possible, right? Without getting into too much detail, we'll just say that circumcision was a covenant which God established with Israel, in which the men were commanded to have a piece of their flesh cut away from a part of their body where they have been known to commit many sins. Notorious for committing sin. And this is a big deal to the Jewish people. They would do this to their little baby boys when they were 8 days old. They would cut that piece of flesh away from their bodies. And it was to be, here's what it was meant to be, it was to be an outward symbol that took place in the physical body, which represented an inner reality within man's heart. This was man saying to God, I am sinful and I need my sinful flesh cut away. This is another thing that the religious Jews had a false confidence in. We are of the circumcision. They were teachers of the law. They had this outward physical ceremony of circumcision that they observed, and these were the reasons why they thought they were acceptable in the sight of God. They thought they were going to be welcomed into God's kingdom just because of all these things. But notice what Paul said there in verse 25. He says, circumcision is indeed profitable if you keep the law. And Paul's already established. They didn't keep the law so well, did they? Preach against stealing, but they're thieves. You preach against adultery, but they're adulterers. They didn't keep the law so well. And so he says, but if you are a breaker of the law, your circumcision has become uncircumcision. And even though they've been so careful to observe that outward religious ceremony, yet Paul says, if you break God's law, it's just like you never did that outward ceremony at all. It did nothing for you. It becomes meaningless. And so we're coming to an understanding here that the outward religious ceremonies that people go through do not have the power to make them right with God. An example of that this morning, we had a lady in the baptistry. And I talked to her before we got in the baptistry, Miss Carolyn. I told her that this is a picture of a reality within your heart. That water can't wash your sin away. It's the blood of Jesus that washes your sin away. That water pictures the grave. And you go under that water, and it's a picture of how, it's a picture of the work Jesus did for you. You go under that water, it's a picture of his death and his burial. You come up out of that water, it's a picture of his resurrection and the new life that he's given you through his death and burial and resurrection on the cross. So the outward symbol doesn't do anything. The outward ceremony, the outward religious rite doesn't save you, doesn't have the power to make you right in the sight of God. Circumcision didn't. And no other religious thing that we do. In fact, Paul goes on to say that it kind of works the opposite way too. In verse 26, he goes on to say, therefore, if an uncircumcised man keeps the righteous requirements of the law, will not his uncircumcision be counted as circumcision? Say, what? Well, let me read it to you like this. If an uncircumcised man keeps the righteous requirements of the law, will not his physical uncircumcision be counted as spiritual circumcision? You understand? And follow Paul's logic. Here's a person who does not have all the religious practice of the law. He's not been through the religious, outward religious ceremonies. But there's one thing Paul tells us that in that verse that can make him right with God. What does Paul say? He must keep the righteous requirement of the law. Now let me explain something here, because it kind of sounds like Paul is teaching us, well, if you keep the righteous requirement of the law, then you'll be justified. Absolutely. But you know what? Nobody does. Nobody did. Nobody has, except for one, and that's Jesus Christ. But if there was a man, and notice that Paul says if. He doesn't say that he does. He says if he does, then his physical uncircumcision will be counted as spiritual circumcision. So it doesn't matter whether he went through that religious ceremony or not, because his keeping of the law takes care of it. Because circumcision was before the law anyway. It's a covenant. It wasn't law. And then verse 27, he goes on and Paul says, And will not the physically uncircumcised, if he fulfills the law, judge you? Now, Paul's talking to the Jew here. And again, notice, Paul doesn't say that he will keep fulfill the law, but he says, if there's a person who fulfills the law, even if he's not a Jew, even though he hasn't been through all the outward religious ceremonies, but if he fulfills the law, then he will judge you. You know that we're going to judge with the Lord. We're going to reign with him in the kingdom. And if you want to stick a knife in the prideful heart of a religious Jew, and you just tell them that Gentiles are going to stand in judgment over them, and you've done it right there, because they couldn't stand the Gentiles. Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh, and he was angry when God rescued them, when God didn't destroy them. That's kind of the way a lot of them felt towards Gentiles. But that's exactly what Jesus told the religious leaders of Israel. I know this offended them, but in Luke chapter 13, Jesus said to them that you're going to see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, and you yourselves are going to be thrust out, but you're also going to see Gentiles are going to come from the east and the west and from the north and the south, and they're going to sit down in the kingdom of God. People coming from all over the world, but you're going to be thrust out. All that religion they had and all that religious ceremony that they observed and went through, and it wasn't enough to save them. Why? Paul makes that clear at the end of verse 27. He says, even with your written code and circumcision, he says, you're a transgressor of the law. If you're going to go about it in that way, you have to do it perfect. And guess what, folks? We can't. None of us have. Only Jesus. Isn't that the exact problem that we've seen with every kind of person that Paul has been talking about from the beginning of Romans until now? Every single kind of person Paul's been talking about. We have the pagan, the one who's so lost and he's headed for hell. And he's lost and he's headed for hell because he's broken God's law. And it's the same for the moral man. No matter how good he may seem, he's still lost and headed for hell because somewhere along the line, he's broken God's law. And it's the same for the religious man. No matter how religious he seems, no matter how many religious hoops he's jumped through, how many things he may have taken the Lord's Supper 127 times and been baptized twice, you know, and just to make sure of it. And he may have done all these religious things, but he's still lost and headed for hell because he's broken God's law. Every one of them. And now he turns to the religious Jew, the most religious person in the world, and says, all your religion that you go through, you're still lost and headed for hell because you have broken God's law. Every one of us has the same problem. And so we all need the gospel. We all need the gospel. And so we come to our final point. That is the fundamental concern. What's the big picture here? Paul makes it very clear. Verse 28. He says, for he is not a Jew who is one outwardly. Remember, he started the verse, he said, thou art called a Jew. You think you're a Jew because of your connection and your knowledge of the law and your rest and all that. He says, he's not a Jew who's one outwardly. He says, nor is circumcision that which is outward in the flesh. It's just a symbol. He says, but he is a Jew who's one inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit. And not in the letter. His praise is not from men, but from God. You see, they may seem to have everything looking right on the outside. And when men look at them, they think, oh, what a stand-up guy. That is who I want to be like right there. But they're missing what they really needed on the inside. In the heart. In the spirit. They may have a piece of flesh cut off the outside of their body. But what they need is their heart cut out of the inside of the body. They need the heart of Jesus Christ put in there in his place. That's what we all need. That's circumcision of the heart. Because they don't have what they need on the inside. They've broken God's law. And you know what they need on the inside? They need Jesus. The gospel message tells us how to find him. He's the only one who ever fulfilled God's law. We've all crashed and burned. God's perfect holy standard. We've all failed. But we need Jesus, the one who did fulfill God's law. Where you love